In this video, we're going to take a closer look at advanced application of Newton's second law of motion. Newton's second law states that the net force of an object equals the object's mass times its acceleration. F sub net equals m times a. Three unknown masses, m1, m2, and m3, hang together on thin wires. If the wires have no mass, and the tension in the string at each point is given as shown, then what are the masses of these objects? From looking at this diagram, we see that the tension force in the top wire, T1, supports all the masses. T2 supports the masses M2 and M3, and T3 supports M3 only. Let's focus on M3 and draw a free body diagram of the forces acting on this mass. The forces acting on M3 are tension, pulling up, and gravity, pulling down. Since M3 is at rest, the net force acting on it is zero. We've made our positive direction up, which means that T3 minus M3 times G equals zero. If we add M3 times G to both sides of the equation and then divide both sides by G, we find that M3 equals the tension in the lowest wire, T3, divided by the acceleration due to gravity, G. Plugging in 21 newtons for T3 and 9.8 meters per second squared for G, we see that M3 equals 2.1 kilograms. Now let's look at a free body diagram on M2. M2 has a tension force, T2 pulling up, a tension force T3 pulling down, and the force of gravity, M2 times G, also pulling down. The mass is in equilibrium, so the total force of M2 is zero. This means T2 minus T3 minus M2 times G equals zero. If we add M2 times G to both sides of the equation and then divide both sides by G, we find that M2 equals T2 minus T3 all divided by G. Plugging in 50 newtons for T2, 21 newtons for T3, and 9.8 meters per second squared for G, we find that M2 equals 3 kilograms. Lastly, to solve for M1, let's look at a free body diagram of the forces acting on this mass. Just like with the other masses, M1 is not moving, so the net force acting on it is zero. That means T1 minus T2 minus M1 times G equals zero. If we add M1 times G to both sides of the equation and then divide both sides by G, we see that M1 equals T1 minus T2, all divided by the acceleration due to gravity, G. Plugging in 78 newtons for T1, 50 newtons for T2, and 9.8 meters per second squared for G, we find that M1 equals 2.9 kilograms. Let's do another exercise of Newton's second law. A rope is hung over a frictionless tree branch. One end is tied to a 23-kilogram crate sitting on the ground, and an 18-kilogram monkey climbs up the other side. If the monkey climbs with an acceleration of 1.7 meters per second squared, how fast does the crate accelerate? What is the highest acceleration the monkey can have without lifting the crate up? Let's begin by drawing a free body diagram of the forces acting on the monkey. There's the force of gravity pulling down and the tension of the rope pulling the monkey up. The tension force arrow is longer because the problem told us the monkey has an upward acceleration as it climbs the rope. The net force on the monkey equals its mass times its acceleration. The positive direction we have chosen is upward. The tension force, F sub T, minus the weight of the monkey, the mass of the monkey times G, the acceleration due to gravity, equals the monkey's mass times its acceleration. We know all the terms here except the tension force, F sub T. We want to solve for that force because it acts on the crate, lifting it up. So if we add the mass of the monkey times G to both sides of the equation and then factor out the monkey's mass from the right side, we see that the tension force equals the mass of the monkey times its acceleration plus G, the acceleration due to gravity. Plugging in 18 kilograms for the monkey's mass, 1.7 meters per second squared for its acceleration, and 9.8 meters per second squared for gravity's acceleration, we find that the tension in the rope is 207 newtons, or 210 newtons when using significant figures. Knowing that, now let's solve for the acceleration of the crate. Draw a free body diagram of the crate. The same tension force that pulls up on the monkey also pulls up on the crate, and the crate also has the force of gravity acting downward on it. Also, when the crate is resting on the ground, a normal force acts upward on the crate. It may turn out that this normal force is zero, that the tension force is enough to counteract the downward force of gravity on the box, and the ground isn't pushing up on the box at all. We can figure that out by comparing the tension force with the force of gravity. The tension force acting on the crate is the same as the tension force on the rope as the monkey moves up it. F sub t equals 210 newtons. The weight force of the crate equals its mass times the acceleration due to gravity, 23 kilograms times 9.8 meters per second squared. That equals 225.4, or with sig figs, 230 newtons. Since the weight force is greater than the tension force, that means the crate continues to rest on the ground. So when the monkey's upward acceleration is 1.7 meters per second squared, the crate remains at rest on the ground. Its acceleration is zero. Now let's solve for the highest acceleration the monkey can have without lifting up the crate. Draw a free body diagram on the crate. The same tension force that pulls up on the monkey also pulls up on the crate. And the crate also has the force of gravity acting downward on it. Also, when the crate is resting on the ground, a normal force acts upward on the crate. When the tension force on the crate equals but does not exceed the weight force, then the normal force on the crate will be zero, and the crate will be as near to being in motion as it can be without actually moving. That's the condition we'll assume that we can solve for the monkey's top acceleration without moving the crate. By looking at this free body diagram, we see that the net force acting on the crate is zero. F sub t minus the mass of the crate times g equals zero. Rearranging our equation, we see that F sub t equals the mass of the crate times g. Plugging in our values for the crate's mass of 23 kilograms and the acceleration due to gravity g, which is 9.8 meters per second squared, we see that the tension force is 225.4 newtons, or 230 newtons when taken into account significant figures. Now let's switch back to the monkey's free body diagram, with our new tension force being applied. By Newton's second law, with the positive direction upward, the tension force minus the monkey's weight equals the monkey's mass times its acceleration. We want to know the monkey's acceleration, so we divide both sides of the equation by the monkey's mass. The monkey's acceleration equals the tension force minus the monkey's mass times g, all divided by the mass of the monkey. Plugging in 230 newtons for the tension force, 18 kilograms for the monkey's mass, and 9.8 meters per second squared for g, we find that the monkey's maximum acceleration without lifting up the crate is 3.0 meters per second squared. Now let's solve another second law problem involving inclined planes. Two blocks, where M1 equals 13 kilograms and M2 equals 27 kilograms, sit on two frictionless planes. The first, elevated at 47 degrees, and the second at 28 degrees. The masses are connected by a rope strung over a frictionless pulley. What is the acceleration of the masses? Assume that motion to the right is positive. Take a minute, press pause, and try this problem out for yourself. Did you find that the system of blocks accelerates to the right at 0.8 meters per second squared? If so, great work. If not, let's go through the exercise together. The key to this problem is understanding that the two blocks are a system. If M1 moves, M2 moves just as much, and vice versa. We'll start by drawing a free body diagram of each block separately. Each one experiences a gravitational force, a normal force, and the tension force due to the rope. We want to find the component of the weight force acting down each incline, so we can compare them and see which way the system moves, or if it stays still. Let's look more closely at block's one free body diagram. The normal force acts on the box perpendicular to the surface. Tension acts parallel to and up the incline, and gravity acts at an angle to the incline, perpendicular to the surface of the Earth. Here, the components of the force due to gravity are drawn in as dotted lines. One component of the force due to gravity acts normal to the plane, and one component is parallel to it. That's the component that acts on the block down the incline in the negative x direction. The angle between the force due to gravity and the normal component of that force is theta 1. From our experience with vector analysis, we know that the component of the weight force pushing block 1 down the incline in the negative x direction, which we'll call F1gx, is the block's mass times the acceleration due to gravity, times the sine of 1 theta. Now let's take a closer look at block 2 free body diagram. Just like with block 1, the normal force acts on the box perpendicular to the surface. Tension acts parallel and up the incline, and gravity acts at an angle to the incline, perpendicular to the surface of the Earth. There's a component of gravity that acts down the incline in the positive x direction. In this case, the component, which we'll call F2gx, equals m2 times the acceleration due to gravity times the sine of theta 2. When we consider the system of blocks 1 and 2 together, these forces along the plane are the only ones that cause the system to accelerate in the x direction. Since all other forces acting on them are acting in the vertical direction and don't affect acceleration in the x direction, the acceleration we are solving for. Applying Newton's second law to the system, we write that the net force equals the combined mass m1 plus m2 times the acceleration of the system. So F2gx minus F1gx equals the combined mass and accelerations of m1 and m2. We want to solve for the system's acceleration, so we divide both sides of the equation by the combined mass. Then replace both forces with the values we arrived at earlier in terms of mass, the acceleration due to gravity, and the angle of the incline. F2gx with m2g sine theta 2 and F1gx with m1g sine theta 1. We can now plug in the numbers given for these variables. The acceleration of the system equals 27 kilograms times 9.8 meters per second squared times the sine of 28 degrees minus 13 kilograms times 9.8 meters per second squared times the sine of 47 degrees, all divided by 40 kilograms. The net acceleration of the system of blocks is 0.8 meters per second squared to the right. That's a closer look at advanced application of Newton's second law of motion. For more physics in motion, go to our homepage, where the entire series is available to you.